إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح للأمة فتركها على المحجة البيضاء، ليلها كنهارها ما زاغ عنها إلا هالك وما استمسك بها إلا مهتد، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وبعد. It is reported in Sahih Muslim by way of Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Islam initiated as something strange, and it would revert to its old position of being strange. So good tidings for the strangers. بَدَأَ الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَأَ فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَى فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَى. I started with this famous hadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because it sums up in a few words the entire situation that Islam and Muslims are going through today. It's a reflection of the current status that we live as Muslims. Now, before I continue, I just want to make sure that the word strange, gharib, is very clear to all of us. Because some might confuse or misinterpret the word gharib and the way it's being used and the connotation of the hadith. Some might think that the Prophet is suggesting that the message of Islam is odd. The principles of Islam are uncommon, and that's why he's using the word strange. Nothing can be further from the truth. What is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is denoting here is that Islam, when Islam was revealed, the majority of people at the time did not receive it well, did not accept it. They were very hostile in their reaction and attitude towards Islam. And those who accepted Islam at the beginning of the revelation were very few. They were targeted, they were defenseless, they were weak, and because of that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam describes the situation as it existed by the time of the revelation, that Muslims and Islam were viewed as strangers, because again, they weren't accepted. And then the Prophet tells us, and it would revert to its old position. What this denotes here is that there is a transitional period between being strange. Is that good now? Because it says it started strange and it will revert to its old position. So there must be a transitional period in between. And it's given since it would revert to the first or to the initial status. That transitional period is the period that witnessed the essential of Islam, where Islam became a major power. Muslims became a superpower. So we started with the stage of being strangers. We went through a transitional period, which was a lengthy period, where Muslims became strong and Islam became a dominant religion, and then it would revert to its initial status, whereas Muslims and Islam become strangers. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us good tidings. So good tidings for the strangers. فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَى. Because at the time when Islam is targeted, at the time when Muslims are targeted, it's not very easy to be a Muslim. It's not very easy to be a Muslim. Brothers and sisters, if you look around you today, if you are aware of your surroundings, you will notice that Islam became a matter of debate, especially in this country. Especially during this election cycle, where now you have candidates, presidential candidates, who are patching Islam. It's not only Donald Trump or Ted Cruz. Many others are going after Islam and Muslims and conflating terrorism with Islam. You know, during this time, if you are paying attention, going back to the word stranger and to the status of being strangers, demonizing Islam and dehumanizing Muslims became a profitable trade, a profitable business. If you look around you, you will notice that the word that we use to describe the hatred of Islam and spreading hatred and fear from Islam, the word Islamophobia, Islamophobia is an industry today. Is an industry that is bankrolled by hundreds of millions of dollars every year. You have people and organizations. You have trends in America, in Europe, in many parts of the world, who are making money, making living, are going after Islam and Muslims. It is a fact, right? It is a fact that we're living. It what resembles the stage of being strangers, as the hadith suggests to us. And unfortunately, it's not that Islam is only being attacked by non-Muslims, but it's also being attacked by many Muslims. Those who understood the profitable component of going after Islam, and they're making money out of it, and once a deserter attacks Islam, you will find that the Western media comes to his or her defense, commending their so-called courage to go against the so-called atrocities that are assigned to Islam and Muslims. And if anyone criticizes them, then you will find an outcry because the freedom of expression is being under assault. But when someone defends Islam, he becomes an apologist. An apologist for the atrocities. An apologist for terrorism that is conflated with our peaceful religion, with our beautiful religion. So it is not easy to be a Muslim today. It is not easy to be a Muslim. Maybe you've seen this minister, I think, either in the UK or France, who mocked hijab just a few days ago. And she related to a woman being wrapped up, you know, it's like packaged. Can you say the same thing about a Jewish woman who's modestly dressed? No, they can't. About a Christian nun? No, they can't. But it is okay to bash Islam. Now, maybe we're living this period. But here were the glad tidings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, becomes relevant to all of us. So good tidings, glad tidings for the strangers. Those who will stand up for their rights. Those who will stand up to defend justice. Those who will stand up to defend the true freedom of expression. You know why I'm saying this and I didn't say those who stand up to defend Islam? Because everything of every good value is an Islamic value. So we shouldn't be ashamed to say, you shouldn't be a bigot, a racist, because this is an Islamic value. Going after Muslims is a form of bigotry and a form of hatred and discrimination. Denying justice to Muslims and to any human being is a form of injustice. So now those who are given the glad tidings are those who are not only proud of being Muslims, but also who work to defend Islam and the values of Islam. The glad tidings is given for those who know their role, for those who understand that they are on a mission. You don't have to be very sophisticated, you don't have to be well-educated, you don't have to be rich to be a good Muslim and to be an advocate of Islam and to be a man or a woman of a mission. Just by projecting, just by expressing, just by embodying the true ethics and the true manners of Islam make us and qualify us to be among those who are given the good tidings and the glad tidings. فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَاء. Brothers and sisters, before I get to the point, to the Quran, let me make this point here. There is an extension to the hadith that is not reported in Sahih Muslim. An extension where the companions asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who are the strangers? فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَاء. So good tidings for the strangers. They asked him, who are the strangers? وَمَنْ هُمُ الْغُرَبَاء. يقول رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم الذين يصلحون إذا أفسد الناس. Those who do good, who try to fix a problem when mischief becomes a phenomena or becomes spread out. الذين يصلحون إذا أفسد الناس. Where are we from this equation? We are witnessing the spreading of mischiefs. Where are we from being a positive and constructive force in this life? الَّذِينَ يُصْلِحُونَ إِذَا أَفْسَدَ النَّاسِ. To qualify, you have to be this positive, not negative force, even if you are pure yourself, even if you cleanse your own soul, but still you need to, in order to be among those who are given the glad tidings, is to be that engaging in human, that engaging individual, that engaging force that has a positive impact, and not just to be negatives. Now, during these very difficult times, many might say, why is it happening? It is so bad for us. It becomes so difficult for us to live as Muslims. But you know, if you will take the Quranic approach to the issue, we should be very positive in dealing with this. You know why? Because the Quran tells us, لا تحسبوه شرا لكم بل هو خير لكم. Don't see it, don't view it, don't look at it as a negative thing or a bad thing that is happening to you. Look at it as a positive thing, because it tests your true belief, it tests your iman, it tests who you are, and it makes you work harder and work more. Because if you take things for granted, they will be taken away from you. But once you feel the pressure, it is that who makes who you are. It is that who defines who you are. It is that who defines your role in this life. Allah Azza wa Jal told us this in the incident of the lie. The lie that was leveled against our mother, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. You know that Aisha was accused of having an affair with one of the companions. It's a long story, I know everyone knows it. She was accused of having an affair with one of the companions. It shook the entire Muslim community. We're talking about companions who were shook, violently shaken by this allegation. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was in a very difficult position. He knows that his wife is innocent. But people were spreading the lie against Aisha. He couldn't stop it until the Quran was revealed to the Prophet, stipulating and confirming the innocence of our mother Aisha and that companion. And I want you to listen to the ayahs. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ جَاءُوا بِالْإِفْكِ عُصْبَةٌ مِّنْكُمْ لَا تَحْسَبُوهُ شَرًّا لَكُمْ بَلْ هُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ لَا تَحْسَبُوهُ شَرًّا لَكُمْ بَلْ هُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ لكل امرئ منهم ما اكتسب من الإثم والذي تولى كبره منهم له عذاب عظيم لولا إذ سمعتموه ظن المؤمنون والمؤمنات بأنفسهم خيرا وقالوا هذا إفك مبين. Verily those who brought forth the slander against Aisha are a group among you. Imagine, they weren't outsiders. They weren't the hypocrites. They weren't the disbelievers. They were a group among the believers. Unto every man among them will be paid that which he had earned of sin. And as for him among them who had the greater share therein, his will be a great torment. Why then did not the believers, men and women, when you heard it, the slander of course, think good of their own people and say, this charge is an obvious lie? What the Quran is telling us here, that you should look at it as a positive thing. Again, consider it not a bad thing for you. No, it is good for you. Because it tested the belief and the iman of every single person. Many of the companions who failed the test knew that they had this weakness. And they fixed it. It's not that they lived with that failure. Actually, they fixed it. And the Quran then reproaches Muslims that why many of you did even believe the story? Why many of you participated in spreading the lie? Why many of you didn't say that this is an obvious lie? Why many of you didn't think better of themselves? Why many of you then stand up and say, this is a big lie that is being leveled against a pure woman, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there was a reproachment here to the Muslims. There was a reproachment even for those who did not even participate in spreading the lie and adhering to it and adhering to its details. Because they weren't positive. They didn't overtake the position, or they didn't take the position where they combat this bigotry and this hatred and this lie and this mischief. So it's not good enough, it's not enough to say that we're good while we're doing nothing to substantiate this claim, while we're doing nothing to transform this positive force that we have within us to be a positive force that everyone feels that has an impact in this life. So brothers and sisters, yes, we might be going through this second stage of weakness, but this stage will be followed by a final stage where Muslims, inshallah, will be re-established in this land, where Islam will again, inshallah, be empowered. You know why? Because Islam is the religion of justice. Because Islam is the religion of humanity. Because Islam does not discriminate based on color, age, race, gender. Islam is to defend everyone and the right of everyone. But what we need to worry about is where are we from this mission? And what we are what are we doing to make sure that we will depart from this stage of weakness to re-empower Islam and Muslims and to re-empower justice. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم، وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. Brothers and sisters, if we go back to the word strange and to this status of being strangers today, you'll find that many Muslims in many parts of the world are feeling the impact of being strangers more maybe than us here. They feel it in Syria today, where their blood means nothing to the world. 500,000 people killed, who cares? Hundreds of thousands or thousands of our sisters being raped, they're just Muslims. That doesn't make it right to go and rape the Yazidians in Iraq. But this is a huge hypocrisy to go and object to the tormentation of a race or a sect and not to speak about another sect. No one is defending Muslims and their honor and their blood. No one is caring about Muslims in Somalia dying from starvation and from drought. It's irrelevant. No one is talking about our brothers and sisters in Myanmar. Who cares? Many parts of the world. Those are the true strangers. And our role, as I said, to be among those who are receiving the glad tidings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is to do something to alleviate and to change the situation. I know that every time I come to this member, I come with a message, I come for a reason. It's not that I like to do it. It's not like I like to ask. It's not that I like to put myself in this position where people are looking at me and say, oh my God, he's asking for money. But you know, if you want to be among those who are given the glad tidings, you need to do something about it. It's not good. It does not stand in the day of judgment to say, Ya Rab, I was afraid that people will know I'm a Muslim. I was ashamed that people will know that I'm a good man. You know, in the story of Lut, when he was calling on his people to leave the great sin that they were committing, what did they say? أخرجوا أهل لوط من قريتكم إنهم ماذا؟ وناس يتطهرون. Expel them from your land. And what the charge was? They're clean and pure. Don't be ashamed that you're clean and pure. Don't be ashamed that you're standing for justice. Don't be ashamed that you're doing something good. Don't hesitate to do something good. Don't hesitate to transform this negative energy that we have, inshallah, all of us have within us, of being clean and pure, to make it an engaging energy, a dynamic energy, an energy that has an impact in this life. We have an organization, one of our organizations, coming to our masjid today, United Muslim Relief, asking us to stand with our brothers and sisters in Palestine today. They do many other causes. Today it is Palestine. They're sponsoring, the family sponsorship is $150 a month, $1,800 a year. I'm hoping that we can sponsor at least five or six families. Five or six families for $1,800 each, which is $150 a month. Five or six families of average seven. And do I need to tell you the situation of your brothers and sisters in Palestine? Wallahi, I feel ashamed to start telling you the situation because everyone knows it. And I feel ashamed to start telling you what the Palestinians are going through while the Syrians are going through the same or worse, or the Bormans or many others. But brothers and sisters, we are entrusted. We are entrusted not only with this money, we're entrusted with the souls, that we have. Everyone is going to die and everyone is going to face Allah and everyone is going to beg to be given a chance to go back and do something right. Dr. Salah Sawi gave the Jumu'ah, last Jumu'ah, and he said when a human being dies and he didn't do good, the first thing he says, Arji'un la'alli as-saddaq. The first thing he will think of, Ya Rab, just give me this chance so I may go and give. So I need, inshallah, a few minutes of your time after the prayer. Let's come together. Let's sponsor. We're almost 1,000 people here. Let's sponsor at least 5, 6, 7 families. Then, if we can, more. $1,800 1 year, $150 a month. Even if you can't give the $150 a month or the $1,800, put $1, $5, $10. With everyone's dollars, we can, inshallah, have a family sponsored or more. So I need a few minutes of your time, inshallah. It's tax deductible. If you have a credit card, a check, book, just go to the offices 1 and 2 and make your payment there, inshallah. And we have the boxes outside. Allahumma ansur al-Islam wa al-Muslimin. Allahumma adhilla al-zalamata wa al-zalimin. Allahumma man arada bihada al-deen khayran fawaffiqhu ila kulli khayr. Wa man arada bihi ghayra thalika fakhudhu akhdha azizun muqtadir. Allahumma arhamna fawqa al-ardi wa tahta al-ardi wa yawma al-ardi alayk. Allahumma waj'alna mimman tuhibbuhum wa tarza anhum wa taghfiru lahum. Allahumma arhamna وارحم والدينا واهدي أبناءنا واهدي أمتنا وأعلي الحق وانصر دينك وانصر العدل يا أرحم الراحمين وأنت يا أخي أقم الصلاة.